Well, the important thing about this story is we opened 10 years after the end of the last film, and we see the apes have now established a colony out in Muir Woods. So it's a very primitive setting, unlike the laboratory settings that we were, you know, spent most of our time on in Rise. But we still wanted to use performance capture, and we had never been able to take it out into a location as remote and as rugged as what we needed to shoot the opening scenes for Dawn. And so that's really where we spent a lot of our effort, is trying to think about what we need to do to all the equipment and the tools to develop, you know, new hardware, new software, new cameras, new facial rigs for the actors to wear. All the pieces had to be redesigned and rethought so that they could just go on location just like all the other, you know, gear that's required to make a film.
I guess the real strength of the performance capture technology is it allows the actors to play characters that they wouldn't be able to play otherwise. They can look and appear to be a chimpanzee or an orangutan or what have you, and they, all the kind of detail and nuance in that actor's performance can drive that digital creature. But the challenge is, you know, in the past that equipment has been sort of stage bound. And on the first film, we started to bring that technology out into the onset location, but we realized for this film, because of the requirements of the story, it was going to take place in the forest and in the rain and the mud. We needed to make it a lot more robust, and in doing so, it allowed us again to be able to put those actors in those environments we wouldn't have been able to get to with our equipment in the past, and still capture every bit of detail that they were putting into those performances.
You can see a very crude version almost instantly, just to know that you've got the shot and the framing, but going from that to the final shots takes several months.
Just constant. I would sit right by Matt's side while we were making the movie, and he'd have questions, and I'd have questions for him, and it was just a constant dialogue. Part of the process that we go through when we're making the film is, you know, in addition to getting all the performance capture, we're also making sure that we shoot the shots in a way that allows us to best lay in our visual effects work. And so that's part of the constant dialogue between him and the first AD and myself, is, you know, what shots we need to get before we can move on to the next shot.
The eyes are very important. We're all used to looking at eyes, and being able to start and end on an extreme close-up like that meant that, because these eyes that we're doing this on are not real, they're digital eyes, and that, you know, the Caesar is digital, we still had to understand what makes that work. And it's a combination of the detail that you see in the eye, all the fibers of the eye and all the veins and the wetness of the eye. You have to have this sort of components right, but then you need to get the subtle movements of the eye, because that's what expresses what the character is thinking. And then suddenly, you know, as you pull back in the opening shot, you have, you know, Caesar, who again is an all digital creation, but the fact that he's got this pose, he's got this body language that supports the intensity that you see in it, just instantly compels you to understand that you're looking at a character here.
So much, Andy, that, you know, one of the things that goes into making eyes read, you know, so clearly, to be able to register the performance through the eyes, is it's also the skin around the eyes and the musculature surrounding the eyes, that as your face makes different expressions, the shape of the skin around your lids changes. And that's one of the things that we actually took from Andy. We took, you know, models of his, digital models of his eyes and the skin folds around his eyes, and put them onto Caesar so that we could more closely match what Andy was doing with Caesar. We had about 12 different versions of Caesar in terms of, like, the different pelts of fur that he was wearing. We had a dry version and a damp version and a wet version. We had versions where he gets wounded in the film, and so there's versions with the wound and without the wound. There's different levels of dirtiness depending on what part of the movie he's in. Lots of different combinations.
And then they all have to react to wind and the dynamics, you know, when he's moving around. The fur, you know, as you know, flies around and rubs against things and you know, just really reacts dynamically. So that was all new software to do that as well.
Our job is all about observation and being able to pick out the details in everyday life and put them into our work. And the more little details we can put into our work, the more that people will believe that they're actually real. The tower fight at the end of the sequence where Koba and Caesar kind of show down and have their fight. That was a tricky one because that space was entirely virtual. There wasn't a real thing in there. And so figuring out what that space was and how they were going to move through it and what we needed to build and at what level of detail, that was a tricky problem.